And so Google has a new product, which we hope will be helpful to us, as they do too, making public data more accessible and easier to analyze and visualize.
So these are users in English and US at a certain point in time. So their interest in, say, unemployment rate, the number two, is of course very high right now, but it might not have been so high 5 years ago. Health conditions, disasters, GDP, last names. People look for Irish last names. Today, we have launched data from the World Bank, triggered on top of the other search results, saying fertility rate world. And we give them the number 2.5, which is quite low in the historical context. You can see how it's decreasing. So numbers in isolation are often not that useful. You need the context. And if you're not an expert, you're not aware of the context. Is 2.5 high or low? So by showing the trend there, people can realize that since 1960, oh, that says actually a very low number. Clicking this chart brings you to a page, we're actually live now, where world is selected, but we can easily add all the other countries we want to. Let's add the United States, and there you go. With two or three clicks, 5 seconds away, I can put them on a chart, and I can link to this chart, or I can embed it in my blog.
That device we just saw by Google could revolutionize what we try to do as investigative reporters, because, you know, by the nature of investigation, you're going so much deeper, and we are often doing that with deep data sets that are tailored to the specific investigation, and the problem has been trying to convert that data into pleasing, simple visuals on our websites.
And we've got a winner. Chlamydia overtook gonorrhea back in 1992, as we all know. I don't know why, but there is someone who knows why, and people deserve to find this data and those stories much, much easier. But to make it useful, there are explanations on the data, which needs to be created by someone who really understands the content. And that piece is really, really hard to scale up with technology. It requires a human brain to analyze the data.
You know, the key part of exploratory data analysis for many instances is being able to rapidly iterate. And so if it takes you a day or a week to build a visualization, that sort of time scale is just not going to support exploratory analysis. It's certainly not in a way that will meet with the hard deadlines that journalists face in the newsroom.
It's contrary to the idea that I've said that editing is super important, that sketching is super important, that you have to learn how to sketch with data. Like, you try on, you know, 8 different formats and the first 7 don't really fit.
So oftentimes we use visualization as a way to get a much more qualitative sense of what's happening in the data, what are the different patterns, which then as we might move into more technical or mathematical approaches, we go, you know, armed with much deeper knowledge of what's going on.
This idea of enabling discovery, of kind of being able to look at the data and discover things in it that you wouldn't have necessarily even thought to look for, is a pretty important part of what we're thinking about at the studio. We're really trying to get away from this idea that you would kind of take a data set, wrap something around it, and then say, here are the conclusions, but make interfaces that allow you to explore and discover and to kind of ask questions that you wouldn't normally think to ask. It's a project called Crime Spotting, and it was started by my partner Mike, who was getting frustrated with the maps of Oakland that were available at the time. This is what a usual map of what the city of Oakland was providing as a map for their for their crime. I think there's a little bra in there for prostitution, and there's the red, you know, there's a little liquor bottle there. And the thing that I'm not showing here is what you are the hoops that you have to jump through in order to get to this map. You basically have to fill out like the census form before you can get a map. What Mike did was to write a bunch of scripts that would go in and kind of extract the data from this map and pull it into something that looked a little more elegant and was a little bit more useful. And the idea is that crimes are kind of generally sorted into 3 types: murder on the red, narcotics in blue, and then theft and vehicle theft in green. On the bottom left, there's a timeline that you can drag and slide and all that. And it's the interface is such that you can start to do things like, you know, roll over a theft and you'll see all the thefts. Here are all the prostitution arrests in about a week period. About 3 days after we launched it publicly, the city of Oakland got freaked out and shut it down. Essentially, you know, kind of, it's called a denial of service. They basically wouldn't let our servers talk to their servers.
After having gone through this really provocational process of, you know, freeing the data in Oakland, San Francisco, while going through their whole like open data initiative, you know, basically came to us and said, hey, we would love to build crime spotting for San Francisco. Here is a KML file that you can use, and gave us, you know, as much crime data as we thought would be necessary. But only after, you know, sticking it into crime spotting and building the site and then like pushing it out, you know, the 24 hours before the big SF Data press release, did we realize that it didn't have alcohol or prostitution or homicide incident. And, you know, I mean, so completeness is, you know, a really important aspect of this stuff.
As a typical journalist, I'm naturally skeptical about how far people are going to go. I mean, usually the outs talk about accessibility and openness, and when they get inside, they find that they have secrets that they want to keep.
You know, even the government data, I still am waiting for somebody to do some really strong analysis of the data.gov data. I mean, that's the neat thing right now, right? Is transparency is the new black.
One of the things about visualization is that it definitely can promote openness just by the fact of it existing. Because the moment you try to make a visualization, you realize you need data. And if you have holes in your data, they can become apparent. And so visualization really can serve two roles. One is the explicit role of letting us see stuff coming. The other is this sort of funny passive-aggressive role that if you need to do a visualization, you find yourself pushed into the mode of wanting to make data open.